it's Michael from Rich Your Diaries, coming to you from my messed up library in Nova Scotia, Canada. I want to talk about Dracula. Well, Dracula by Bram Stoker, a free ebook I got from feedbooks.org, and you can get it for, or is it .com, and you can get it from Kobo, and I think you might be able to get it from Kindle. Definitely from Gutenberg.org. And then the other one is Bram Stoker's Dracula, directed by Francis Ford Coppola, starring Keanu Reeves, Gary Oldman as Dracula, and a wonderful over-the-top campy performance by Anthony Hopkins, who basically gives campy performances in the last 20 or 25 years. I was going to read this book for many, many years. I just decided that I would do it. Might as well close that down since it's moving around. And it went on and on and on, much like my videos. It just went on and on and on. I want to say that I enjoyed it quite a bit, but there is a large element of tedium in that book. The first part of it, where Jonathan Harker goes to Transylvania and his whole journey to get there through the mountains and getting into the castle and the wolves around and all of that sort of stuff, very atmospheric, very well done. The whole novel is first person diaries, letters, newspaper accounts from him, his friends back in England, from Dr. Van Helsing, from Mina and Lucy, the main characters. So there's lots of that. There's no third-person narrative in the book. So the first part is Jonathan Harker talking about how he comes to this feeling, no shit, Sherlock, that he might be a prisoner of the Count. Then there's the middle of the book, the biggest part of the book, and a lot of it is extremely tedious. The parts about Lucy, who she's got three suitors, one of them a Texan. Americans and Texans were very considered very exotic and robust, and a complete antithesis of the reserved British in Victorian and Edwardian England. So they would end up as characters in novels more than once, I believe, but he's in there anyway. So you've got all of this stuff going back in England, and Jonathan Harker is off the page completely. He's not anywhere in the book, because we don't even know what's happening to him. He's trying to get back to England, and the Count is on his way by sea. That part of the book, the narrative by the professor, the sea captain, was very, very good, very exciting. Lucy's encounters with the Count coming in and basically bleeding her dry up there, they were quite atmospheric as well, but it went on too long, bringing Dr. Van Helsing in, trying to figure out what's going on. And it just went on a long time. It could have been a couple of hundred pages. And then Lucy has to meet her demise. You've seen this in movies over the years, so it's not like I'm telling secrets. And that's what, and I certainly expected to see it. Then you have another part of the narrative, which is a bit slow too, is Jonathan Harker does get back to England. And he has gray hair by this point, even though he's still young, because of his horrific experiences in the castle. And then so his betrothed is Wilhelmina, and she gets under the spell of the Count and all of that sort of stuff. And then you get another part where Van Helsing and the trio of men are lucky in getting rid of some of the different crates that the Count was going to, or had secreted around London, so they could start taking over England, basically. So they had some success, so the Count actually had to get back home, and he had to go by sea. And so the end of the book is actually the resolution about, killing Dracula. And that was all much ado about nothing, because they finally get to the end where Lucy's three beaux, including her husband, and she was now a widower, and Van Helsing and Jonathan Harker, they all and Mina, they all end up going to back to Transylvania, Romania, Budapest, whatever, and back to the castle. And considering how long this novel took, you get the resolutions actually about two pages. I was surprised at how quickly Dracula was dispatched. And I mean that seriously. So the book is too long, but I didn't write it, I read it. And the book is from the late 1800s, so they have their own leisurely pace. And there's a lot of good in it, a lot of good. But Van Helsing gets a bit tiring with his fake Dutch accent or whatever. Not fake, but he's Dutch. So in the novel, all these funny malapropisms and the wrong grammarian use of words, things like that. That sort of thing, when it's on the page, is really, really, it really slows you down. So he didn't speak like Peter Cushing by any means. So anyway, there's a lot of good in it, and it did start a lot of the craze, but it does take a lot of reading, and I'm a very fast reader, and I thought it would never end. But I still recommend it, because then you can watch something like this, Bram Stoker's Dracula, and a lot of the book is actually in here. As far as changes, this screenplay did put Mina into much closer contact with Dracula, Gary Oldman, while he had a lot of blood and satiation and rest and all of this. So then he was a young looking Gary Oldman. He wasn't decrepit looking. And then she was waiting for Jonathan Harker to either return or survive, because there was all this confusion. But she basically ends up in a relationship with Count Dracula, which was not in the book. And I don't think it was consummated. I was watching it the other day, but I don't think that's what they were indicating. But she was a very horny Victorian, and she was looking for love, okay? So I thought that was perhaps a very modern twist to the story, but I don't think it added any value to the story. But they did have the part in here where Van Helsing puts a communion wafer on her, and she ends up having a burn in her forehead, so they knew that she was still in thrall to the Count. So that was interesting, and that was the part that had to be played out. Now, Van Helsing, as played by Anthony Hopkins, is very, it struck me as so amusing this time, because I've seen this movie at least twice before. I think at least twice before, 2 days ago. But it's been a long time, and his performance is actually very much in tune with the performance, the characterization in the novel. And that surprised me, the silly things he says in it. We're all in the book, if I recall correctly. Gary Oldman, he can't give a bad performance. I still think he likes flouncing around in those outfits, because who else that's so short, who is so short and has that wasp waist can trail a red robe or whatever through the castle, you know, like at the beginning of the movie. It's just so amusing, you know. But he was good. His performance is good. It's very interesting. And it compared to the original 1931, which was of course done in a time of black and white and very overblown performances by somebody like Bela Lugosi, who didn't speak English without having an accent. He had a very thick accent and was from the theater, so he had broad movements, and that he's the one who articulated what people thought Dracula was like all those years. But once you read the book, you realize Dracula's nothing like Bela Lugosi. He's more, to my way of mind, according to the book description, I think he looks more like Daniel Day-Lewis, actually. And it's supposed to be tall and with very sharp features. And that's one thing that Bela Lugosi doesn't have, sharp features. Also, even Gary Oldman doesn't have any sharpness to his face, you know, as far as that goes. And he's very short, unlike the count is supposed to be taller. But he still conveys the sense of dread, right? And had a sex appeal, especially in the beginning of the movie, where he's portraying Dracula when he was actually a soldier and a prince and fighting and committing all of these atrocities and, you know, supposed to be basically Vlad the Impaler and putting everybody on spikes and things like that. But I highly recommend that you read the book or skim the book if you like, and watch this movie. This is so well done because it's all filmed in the Culver City studios. There's no location shooting. It's all an artistic exercise. I think it was probably done in digital because Coppola was ahead of his time with that. And I just think it's very, very interesting. And I think Keanu Reeves does a good job as Harker, and that his voice is all not that strange just because you know him from Point Break. And you expect him to talk in a certain surfer dude way or whatever, the policeman way. I think he actually, his sort of otherworldly performance that he gives anyway, because he often doesn't seem like he's in the scene that he's in most of his movies, I think. There's something stilted about his delivery. I think it actually works quite well. I thought he did a pretty good job in this. As did Winona Ryder, Richard E. Grant, Billy Campbell, Sadie Frost was Lucy, Tom Waits was Renfield, etc., etc. And I'm probably leaving a few people out. Anyway, this is Michael's book in the film. I'm so glad I saw this again, and I'm glad I read the book, but it is a long read with a lot of tedious parts in the middle. Anyway, it's Michael from Red Shirt Diaries, and oh, my hair is almost as magnificent as Gary Oldman's in the beginning of Dracula, with his hair that looked like somebody's bum. I've got my Kramer hair today because when it gets long, I can't do anything with it unless I have a shower and blow dry it, and I haven't had a shower yet today. Isn't that something? Look at it, it's all over the place. Anyway, we'll see you around the tube.